So I'm going to bring up my magic pen here, and we're going to go step by step by step through this policy statement. And again, there's nothing special about this policy statement. In fact, I took a very generic policy. No bells, no whistles, just a basic whole life insurance policy. So I'm going to have my highlighter here. The summary date, if you were to see the date, this is actually a policy that has a summary date of just a few weeks ago. I would have a place on my policy statement that would also indicate what my policy number would be and when my policy was issued. The date of issue means the date the policy began, not when I applied for it, but when it was approved by the insurance company and when the first premium was paid. The anniversary date will be the anniversary of that policy issue. So this is where it's going to be somewhat different than what you may see regarding an investment statement. An investment statement, typically, you might get a statement at the end of every quarter and then a statement at the end of the year. When you are looking at a whole life insurance policy, everything is based on the date of issue. So if your date of issue was July 15th of 2000, that means every July 15th of every year, that is when you would be receiving your annual statement, because that is when it is yet 1 year older. So when the policy begins, that's the issue date. The anniversaries will be based on when that anniversary date occurs. It has nothing to do with the calendar. The maturity date. Now, the maturity date refers to when the policy ends. And the way that insurance policies end under current actuarial tables, which have been approved and designated by the National Association of Insurance Commissioners. Every single state has an insurance commissioner. They work in tandem with one another. And when they make large wholesale changes in the regulations regarding life insurance, they do it as a group. So some years ago, the National Association of Insurance Commissioners decided to use a brand new mortality table because people are living longer and longer. When I began my career over three decades ago, it wasn't unusual for most life insurance policies to go to age 100. I remember the conversations at that time. People would pause and say, age 100? Who lives to age 100? Well, look at the newspaper. If you go to the obituaries on a regular basis, you will see that many people are dying at age 100 or 102 or 3 or 5. So realizing that these improvements were made on a national basis with the population, the National Association of Insurance Commissioners needed to change the end date, the guaranteed end date, of whole life insurance contracts, which is now age 121. So the maturity date will either be 121 years of age is when it is expected to end, or your individual death, whichever comes first. Basic information there. Also, we will now go down and we'll say that the primary insured, that would be the individual that the life insurance is on. And then we have a notation here as far as death benefit and cash value. Let's pause here for a moment so we can discuss this. When I'm looking at the death benefit, I want you to realize that the death benefit is going to be based on, it's going to be based on, let's see, where's my little, okay, dismiss that, press that. Okay, it didn't work again. I got too many things going on here. All right, got that. And okay, I've got all these different colors and I don't use the annotator that often, so I wish I was more, I wish I was smoother at this, so just bear with me. The death benefit. Now I've got my little annotator here. And okay, got that. Go here. Okay, golly, I keep on having the same issue. Let's just do it this way. Okay, now I've got my little arrow. Death benefit. The death benefit, if you put together the life insurance policy correctly, if it's done the correct way, the life insurance benefit will be income tax free. That is a huge thing. Income tax free. Likewise, your life insurance policy also has a cash value. I like to refer to that as equity. Think of it as equity. In fact, if a person uses an analogy of a home, your home has equity inside of it. It has cash value. In fact, when a person discusses their house, a banker oftentimes will say, we need to figure out what the equity is of your house so you can take a loan against it. What they're really determining is what is the cash value of your house minus any loan that might be there as of right now. All right, so we're going to be looking at a basic chassis. We're going to be looking at a basic chassis, and let me highlight this here, the basic policy or chassis. Now, the reason that I blacked out the word prior to what I call the base policy is oftentimes an insurance company will come up with some sort of whiz-bang name for their policy. Let's call it the ABC life insurance policy, or the Life 95 policy, or the life-sustaining policy. They will come up with some sort of branding, some sort of term to refer to this particular policy. But what we're really looking at is really what is that base policy? It is the chassis. It is the starting point. So when this policy was taken out, it was worth $250,000. And over the years, as this person has been putting money into this policy, it now has an equity, think of it as a house again, or a cash value of $73,730. So I like to have the analogy again of a house. So think of it, if I own a home that's worth $250,000, think of this as I have an equity value in my house, in my policy, of $73,730. All right, still having problems with that one writing tool. That is really kind of driving me crazy, but I think I'm going to be okay. Let's scroll down here a little bit more. There are some other things that I want to be taking a look at as well. I have some additional benefits that are built into this particular policy. These are things that are kind of nice that they're built in the way that they work out. One is called a waiver premium benefit. And I understand why it's named this. I wish it was named a little bit differently than waiver or premium benefit, because this is really kind of a disability clause. If a person is unable to work because of a sickness, an accident, a disease, something that has caused them to be unable to go into work and to be able to fulfill the substantial duties of their job, this particular policy is set up where it has a waiver premium benefit. Now, what that means is that the premium will be waived, meaning that the insured, the person who has the policy and it's on their life, is that they will not need to pay premiums after a certain period of time. And with every company, it's slightly different. There might be a four-month wait, or some companies have a six-month wait. Think of that as a deductible. So I'm disabled, I'm unable to work, So now I have to wait 4 months or 6 months. Think of that as your deductible. And while I'm waiting, the insurance company is doing all that they need to do behind the scenes, talking to doctors, having you checked out, making sure that you truly are disabled, are unable to work. And then as soon as that time has passed, that 4 months, that 6 months, what they will do once you qualify is that they will waive the premium, meaning that you no longer have to pay the premium while you are disabled. But instead of just keeping the insurance alive and going without a premium coming from your pocket, and this is a key with a whole life insurance policy, is that the insurance company begins paying the premium on your behalf. So not only are you receiving the life insurance that will continue, but the insurance company is actually putting the money into your plan for you. So not only is the insurance company continuing the life insurance, but they're continuing the building up of the equity inside your policy. Now, this particular policy has something which is called a five-year own occupation. This is actually quite nice. Most companies have something which is called a two-year occupation. And this is what this means. Whether it's a two or whether it's a five, it means for those first two or 5 years that the definition of disability is going to mean, can the insurer, can you do the job that you were doing before you became disabled? So here's a story that I think works out very, very well. I explained this last week when I was presenting at a national conference. Many, many years ago, I had an opportunity to be in San Diego, California. And while I was there, I had a chance to have a conversation with someone in a lounge, kind of a bar restaurant. And during the course of the conversation, he asked, well, what do you do for a living? And I started to ask him what he did for a living. And as we're talking about money and finances and different things, he says, you know, I've got this really unusual thing in my life right now. I've got this life insurance policy that I'm not paying on, but the insurance company is paying for me. And I was kind of curious. So I said, well, tell me a little bit more about what this situation is all about. And he said, almost 5 years ago, he said, I used to be a chips guy. You know, one of those motorcycle highway patrol officers. I would spend my day out on the highway, on my motorcycle, in, well, I was going to say fresh air, but it's California, in the air. And I did my job basically on my motorcycle. But then I got this inner ear problem. And ever since then, I have had problems with my balance and I have not been able to ride a motorcycle. So the state patrol took me off of the chips routine and I was relegated to a desk job. He says, this is where got very, very interesting. So I had this life insurance policy and I became disabled, unable to do my regular occupation, being a chips. So he said, with this life insurance policy, there was a short waiting period of time, but as soon as that period of time was over, the insurance company has been paying the premium on my behalf for nearly the last 5 years. And he says, I never made less money. In fact, I've made raises during this period of time. I never lost any income, but I had to have a change in jobs because I was disabled from the first. And he says, the unfortunate thing is, with kind of a smile on his face, he said that now I need to begin paying my premiums again because after the 5 years, the life insurance policy uses a definition that goes very similar to these words. Are you disabled based on your age, your skill level, and your education? Now, obviously, the insurance company is not going to be so difficult to make it impossible. He was employed. It's just he was no longer employed with the original job. So he never missed, a payment was never missed. The insurance company is actually the one that made that payment on his behalf. So he's probably a perfect example on how that 5-year own occupation works right there. In fact, I asked him, I said, you know, the 5-year own occupation is kind of an interesting situation. Can you tell me a little bit about the insurance company that that happens to be with? And it was funny because he actually named this particular life insurance company as the one that he had the insurance policy with. So that was really kind of a unique situation that it worked out that way. Okay, so let's take a look at some other things going on here. I'm going to change my colors here a little bit. I also, you can see here that there's something which is called an expiry date. The covered insured would be the person here. The expiry date is typically the waiver of premium benefit goes through typically the age of 65, because most people are going to be retired at the age of 65. So that coverage, typically, if a person were to become disabled, they have to become disabled prior to the age of 65. And there are some benefits, depending upon the particular contract, that can continue to pay your premium potentially forever or for a period of time beyond age 65. There's also something which is called a accelerated death benefit. What that is, I wish the insurance companies would change the names on this. The accelerated death benefit is really your Make-A-Wish Foundation. I wish they would change it because who wants to accelerate their death? Not me. But the rider is called an accelerated death benefit. What that means is, in the event that someone were to become terminally ill, if the insured who has this policy, if they become terminally ill, the insurance company, after getting the right documentation from a doctor, they would allow the person under this particular contract access to 50% of their death benefit prior to death to do whatever they want. Perhaps they need money to try some medical procedures that have not been tested, that have not been approved. Perhaps they would like to take a trip to Florida. They would like to do something that they've never done before. One of the times that I have actually completed the paperwork so one of my clients could take advantage of the accelerated death benefit was to have his roof reshingled. Now, bear with me on this. That might not seem like an important thing. The roof would have been reshingled after his death, because what many people don't realize, it's a prepayment of a death benefit prior to death, but the remaining balance of the available death benefit is then payable after the person has died. So the roof would have been shingled anyway. It would have been repaired anyway. But this man wanted to know, wanted to see, wanted to be assured that the roof was going to be replaced prior to his death, because he had so little control in his life. This is something that I actually discuss in my book, Investments Don't Hug, Embracing the Life Insurance Asset. This I talk about in one of the chapters. This man was dying of brain cancer, but he wanted to know that he did something for his family, that he felt that he was in control. He needed to know for himself. He needed to know with his own money that the insurance company provided. He wanted to know, he wanted to be assured that things were going to be okay. This gave him some solace as he was going through this journey to the end of his life. That is one of the awesome things that can be done with an accelerated death benefit. So we've got the waiver of premium, we've got the accelerated death benefit. Let's go over here and scroll down a little bit further. Okay, we're now getting into some of the money. People are always, Mark, talk about the money. It talks about, it sounds very similar to the movie Jerry Maguire. Show me the money. So here's, in fact, this is called the financial information. There are monthly automatic premiums. This particular policy, the person has been paying $376.47 per month. Now, just a pause. Remember, one life insurance policy is not the end-all, do-all in your life. I own multiple life insurance policies. Clients of mine own multiple life insurance policies. You need to consider your life insurance planning like a portfolio. They build as you get older, as you make more money, as you want more cash readily available for emergencies and opportunities. Always be thinking portfolios. If you run into an agent, an advisor, a representative who says, I've got the newest, the best, let's get rid of everything that you've had in the past because I've got something that's new and improved, don't walk, but run. Because oftentimes I believe that that person is looking for themselves. They're not looking at the overall strategies of how these all work together. When someone comes to me, it is very seldom that we will ever make a change with what they already have unless it really is something that needs to be fixed that we can't fix any other way. Otherwise, if it's doing what it should be doing, we want to make certain that it works in tandem, in unison with everything that is going on in their life. So I have a premium that is being done on an annual basis, which is basically the monthly times 12. We come up with our annualized premium of $4,517.64. Now, remember, because of the waiver premium benefit, it's important to state that if this person becomes disabled, this is the amount of money that is going to be waived. So in the event of a disability, the insurance company is potentially on the hook to put away $4,517.64 for this individual, potentially, depending upon the contract language, for the person's lifetime. Do you have that built into your 401k? I think not. I've never seen it, and I've been doing this for over 30 years. Is this built into the money that you put into your Roth IRA each and every year? I think not. I've never seen it. This is one of those unique products that you can build it in such a fashion that the higher the premium, the better, because now the insurance company is on the hook for that higher premium. And if you became disabled, do you want an itsy-bitsy, teeny-weeny premium that the insurance company has to pay, or do you want as big of a premium as possible that they will be on the hook for? The higher the premium, the better for the disability clause, the waiver of premium benefit, and also to do the things that you want it to do if you don't become disabled, because that's not really the plan. The disability that we might have is an oops, let's plan for it just in case. But we don't want our end game to be, good golly, I hope I become disabled. We just want to make sure that we have all of our bases covered. Note here that it says paying your premium on an annual or a semi-annual basis may provide you some savings. I want to talk a little bit about that because I think it's important to understand the whys to that. The insurance company with a whole life insurance policy is going to be basing everything on an annual amount that goes in. So let's kind of take a look at this. If I'm looking over the course of a year, and this is 1 year out, and this is, you know, the beginning right now, I've got 1 month, 2 months, 3 months, 4 months, 5 months, 6 months, 7 months, 8 months, 9 months, 10 months, 11 months, 12 months a year. Okay, so here's 1 year. Is that if I pay my premium for one whole year, so I got my money here, and it goes all the way out here to 1 year, the insurance company has the use of my money for an entire year to not only pay for the insurance, but also to be able to do the funky, cool things inside my policy, making me money. But if I am paying on a monthly basis, remember, using blue here, I've got part of my money that's only going to be there for 1 month, because if I'm paying monthly, and again, let's just for simplicity's sake, talk about a calendar year. If I've got a policy that begins January 1st, then this would be representative of the premium payment that I made on December 1st. It's only going to be there for 1 year. And then one of the premiums is only going to be there for 2 months, 3 months, 4 months, 5 months, 6 months, 7 months. See how this goes all the way out? So in essence, there is only 1/12 of the premium that was there, if I'm paying on a monthly basis, that's there for an entire year. So the reason that I'm bringing this up is because of that, the insurance company typically charges a little bit more on a monthly basis than what they would pay on a semi-annual or an annual basis, because they don't have the use of your money to be able to make money if you do it on a monthly basis as compared to an annual basis. Now, let's talk about the use of your money, because this would be something important to talk about as well. The insurance companies that we are taking a look at, that we want to do business with, are going to be mutual life insurance companies that offer participating policies. If you hear nothing else today, this is the most important thing. I want to deal with a mutual life insurance company. Now, why? What does a mutual insurance company even mean? A mutual insurance company is a company that does not have stockholders. Now, there are life insurance companies that have stockholders, and that insurance company, guess who they have to keep happy first? Numero uno are the stockholders. A mutual life insurance company is analogous to a credit union. If I am a member of my credit union, in essence, as a member, I am also an owner of that credit union. I'm an owner of the credit union. So they have to do what's best for me, because they don't have stockholders to keep happy. They need to keep me happy. The same thing with a mutual life insurance company. A mutual life insurance company is owned by its policy owners. So I am an owner of the insurance company, and they have to do what's right for me. And if I have a participating contract, that also means that I am participating in the profits of the insurance company. So I want the insurance company to be able to have my money, because the better that they do with my money, the better I do with my money, because I am an owner. So two things: a mutual whole life insurance company using participating policies. I want to participate in the profits of the insurance company. I want to be their numero uno. So let's get into the money. I have a annual premium. Let's see if I can possibly change the color here. Maybe I can. Yes. So my annual premium is $4,517.64. The guaranteed cash value that was stipulated inside my contract says that this particular year, that there was a $4,955 gain of the equity of the cash value inside my life insurance policy. Let's take a look at this again. I paid $4,517.64 in. My insurance policy grew by $4,955. At this point in time, I could probably just say we're finished because this is cool enough already. This is awesome. Now, obviously, this particular client has had this policy for a while. He's been building it up for a while. But what's really cool is inside the contract, that number, that $4,955, that is a number that I can actually find inside the life insurance contract that was promised me. In addition, though, I also have something else. To give myself a little bit of space, let's take out that circle. Let's go back here and take a look at this dividend that I have. I also have a dividend that is available as well. Now, the insurance company, there's my little doohickey here. The insurance company, there's my yellow dividend. The insurance company had a profit this year, and my share of the profit is going to be $332.91. Let me talk about the dividends and profit. And Mark, where the heck did this dividend come from? Okay, so this is where the dividend comes from. The dividend comes from three different things. They come from mortality. This is basically a thank you. You know what? We're going to give you a refund because you didn't die this year. You didn't die this year, and a whole bunch of other people didn't die this year because we picked the people who are dying later than what the average is or what we have budgeted for. So the better that the insurance company does in figuring out who's going to die and who's going to live, because remember, this is the business they are in. If they have less death claims than what they had budgeted for, there's money left over at the end of the year. And that's one of the things that they will take into consideration as far as paying a dividend. There's a profit because we didn't have to pay out as much in death claims. So when people sometimes will say, well, you know, insurance companies, they don't even want to pay death claims. I think that's awesome. I don't want them to pay death claims either because that means that I didn't die. I don't want to get a death claim on my life. I want that to be detoured and delayed as long as possible. And if the insurance company is bright enough to have those people that can figure out who's going to live, who's going to die, who's going to have the extended life, I want to be with that insurance company because that's going to have more money inside my policy. Mortality, number one. Number two, administration costs. The lower that administration costs can go down on a regular basis, the more money that there is at the end of the year and more money that can be applied to your dividend. My general feeling is with AI, with technology, I believe that insurance companies, all companies, are paying less and less and less for administration. And when your policy was set up, it was presumed a certain level of administrative costs. If that cost goes down, there's more money at the end of the year. There's a profit. What happens to that? It goes to you because you are an owner of the insurance company. So mortality, administration, lastly, portfolio. And with a whole life insurance company, with a participating policy, you get to participate in the returns of their entire portfolio, the entire amount of money that keeps the company going from day to day. The better they do with their money, the better mortality that they have, the lower the administration costs, that is what goes into determining whether there will be a dividend payable. Now, with the dividend payable, how is it divided up? That surplus, that extra money, is divided proportionally with all the policy holders of the company. That doesn't mean that they each get $10. It means they get their proportional share based on the amount of money inside their policy and what they have with the insurance company. So if I take a look back on this, I've got a dividend. Take my magic pen here. Let's go blue this time. I got my magic dividend here. And the thing is, it's not really magic, but it almost appears to be that this particular year, I've got an extra $332.91 that is payable to me because of my policy. So the best way to be able to determine what the real amount of cash that has built up over time is to be able to take the guaranteed cash value increase, $4,955, that came from the cash value, the guaranteed cash value increase, plus the dividend payable this year, $332.91. We add those two things together, and for a policy that I put in $4,517.64, the overall increase of my policy for this past year has been $5,287.91. Awesome. Now here's what's great. The guaranteed cash value increase is guaranteed. Dividends are not guaranteed. Again, that's based on the profitability of the company. They can go up, they can go down. In fact, there is nothing that says the insurance company has to pay a dividend whatsoever. But most of the mutual life insurance companies that I know that had been around in excess of 100 years have always paid a dividend. Now, it doesn't mean that they're guaranteed. There can always be a situation where a dividend might not be paid or it might be greatly reduced. Even the mutual life insurance companies that I'm familiar with during the Great Depression, the late 1920s, early 1930s, the ones I'm familiar with paid dividends. They were very, very low. But they paid dividends during a period of time that many companies went out of business. So it's not the amount of dividend. It's to say that based on the profitability of the company, I get to share with those dividends. Now, what do you do with a dividend? There are a couple different things that you can do. So let's go over them one by one. And I'm going to talk about the four generic dividends that a person typically would find. First of all, the amount of the dividend, what did we say? It was like $300, $400. Let's call it $300. One of the ways that you can receive a dividend is in the form of cash. You just get a check. Here's your $300. And again, if the insurance company, if the agent correctly put the policy together for you, that dividend should be income tax free. So let's say you're going to get a check for about $300. And I humorously tell people, you know what you could do with that dividend? Why don't you and your wife take me and my wife out to a really nice restaurant? That should be enough for a great dinner, a few bottles of wine. We'll have a wonderful time. So one of the options is cash. Well, for as much as I would have great appreciation for that to play out exactly that way, the next day, the insured would not have anything to show for it. So I guess I would have to say, you know what, taking it in the form of cash is probably not the smartest thing to do. But it is an option, cash. Number two, you could take the dividend and you could use it now or in the future to either reduce or possibly eliminate any future premiums that would come due. So number two is premium reduction. And that is something that typically we talk about later on in life. The funny thing is, usually I will find people in their mid-60s, late 60s, 70s, and even 80s that are still paying the premiums on their life insurance policies, not because they have to, but they realize it's one of the safest, best assets that they have, and they just wish to keep on putting money in. So you can obviously stop later on, but again, many of my clients are hard-pressed to do that because they see how wonderful this product actually can be for them. But that is one of the options. We could take the dividend and we could reduce the premium. Option number three, we could take that dividend and we can have it sit inside the policy at interest. And depending upon the particular insurance company, there is usually some fixed interest rate, which is usually very, very competitive, even on the guaranteed side, that they get a level interest rate year by year by year. So this is one of the options. This is one of the options I don't care for. Excuse me. And here's why. The dividend would be income tax free if done properly. But the interest that is earned on that dividend, the interest earned on that dividend would be taxable. And I love my country, but there are times I just can't stand my government. And I don't want them to get any more money than they absolutely have to. So I don't like that 1099 that is provided at the end of the year showing that the interest that has been paid on the dividend. So I usually kind of scratch that out. It is the third option that's available, but it's typically one that I don't like. What the default is, and the option that I usually tell people to take, is what's called paid up additional insurance. So let me just highlight this here. Additional paid up insurance. Additional paid up insurance. Now, most guys especially would say, Mark, I don't even want any additional insurance. Let me walk you through this one step at a time so you've got a better appreciation as far as how this works. We take this dividend and we apply it to increase the policy's cash value. The cash is still there. It is still there. It is still there. But we're literally wrapping the cash value in additional paid-up insurance. Now notice, it's providing additional. So this is above and beyond. It's paid up, which means you never pay for it again. It's not like you're getting it this year and now you got to pay for it again next year and the year after that. It's additional and it's paid up. And in this case, because of the age of this individual, it provides them an additional amount of insurance of $668.36. Now, again, this is one of those reasons, excuse me, that most people say, I don't like insurance because I'm always worth more dead than alive. Bingo. This is why it's called insurance. Even though it's done on a very, very small basis, the dividend is $332.91. The additional paid-up insurance is $668.36. Yes, you are worth more dead than alive. This is part of the IRS code that makes this dividend be treated in a special way because it's literally being hidden, though it's still there, inside additional paid-up insurance. Now, here's the key. We're going to go back up here to the top. And you can see that we've got that original base chassis here. We have our $250,000. It has an equity of $73,730. Just below there, you will see this additional insurance that has been built up with time. The additional paid-up insurance purchase, how did we purchase it? It automatically was purchased through the use of dividends. It has an additional death benefit that we have accumulated because remember, yes, I'm worth more dead than alive. So the death benefit is $5,060. The cash value is about half that, $2,520.41. Here's the deal. A lot of people think, I'm taking this dividend, I'm hiding it in insurance. Now that money is gone. That money is still there. You can decide at any point in time, you know, I would like to surrender some of those previous paid up additional insurances that I purchased over the years. I don't want that. Just surrender that. Guess what? You are going to get the value of that, which is the $2,520.41. That money is still there. It's always there. But here is the magic key. If, let's change colors here. If, let's go with blue. if the original cash value of the basic chassis, if that pays a dividend, wouldn't it also make sense that the additional paid up insurance would also pay a dividend? And isn't that like getting interest on top of interest? And wouldn't that be cool if we could do that without getting a 1099 form at the end of the year, so we legally, ethically, and morally didn't have to pay taxes on that? And wouldn't that be something that we would celebrate? And the answer would be yes. So I've got this equity that's building up. Properly put together, I've got an income tax-free death benefit. And now I put these two numbers together. So I didn't start out with a $250,000 policy. I mean, that's what I did start out with, but now I have a $255,000 policy. How many times have you seen something where you pay the same amount of money, but you have increased value over time? I mean, every single year on your homeowner's insurance, don't you pay more and more and more? And basically, I mean, you've got coverage. I mean, there's nothing magic that's happening there. And I also have this cash that's also available for the use of emergencies or opportunities. What would this mean to you if you had the flexibility of knowing on this particular year that you've got $76,250.41, and this is just one of the policies inside your portfolio, and that I can name, we've got it blocked out here, but I can name that someone will get this after my death, the total death benefit, the $255,000, after all the paperwork has been done, typically a few weeks, and it's there without any questions, without going through probate, if properly put together. I want to make sure that my primary beneficiary is put together, an individual's name. In this case, this person must have children, so they have the estate listed as the contingent, so their will dictate how that money is paid out. But I've got all these magical things happening for a premium of about $4,500 each and every year, that I've got more than $5,000 that's being increased each and every year. This is available to me that I can borrow against. This is available to me that I can withdraw without any problem whatsoever. This is available to me that I don't have to worry about the tax man. The tax man does not cometh under this situation. This provides me some certainty if I need my own individual Make-A-Wish Foundation. This supplies me certainty in the event I become disabled and I am unable to work, that the plan is going to be self-completing. I look at this whenever I review an annual statement with a client. I look at it and I think to myself, what is not to love on how this works? It's part of your overall strategies, but it's the one that provides certainty. It's the one that provides guarantees. This is the reason that I wrote my book, Investments Don't Hug, Embracing the Life Insurance Asset.